Good afternoon. Can I remind members that social distancing measures are in place in the chamber and around the campus? I ask members to observe these measures when entering and exiting the chamber, and please only use the aisles and walkways to access your seat or when you are moving around the chamber. The first item of business is portfolio questions, and the first set of questions on justice and veterans. If a member wishes to ask a supplementary, I would ask them to indicate in the chat function if they're joining us remotely, or press the request to speak button during the appropriate question. And we start with question number one from Rhoda Grant.
To ask the Scottish Government what plans it has to review the legislation on commercial sexual exploitation during the current parliamentary session.
Minister Ash Denman.
Last week, we published in the Programme for Government the Scottish Government's commitment to develop a model for Scotland which effectively tackles men's demand for prostitution, and we will take this forward within this parliamentary term. Due to the complexities of this issue, we require to assess not only the legislative needs of our chosen model, but also the support available for those involved in prostitution. We'll be commissioning a programme of lived experience engagement to further inform this work. There are many countries that have adopted a challenging demand model which we can also learn from. So we're working on a comprehensive international review to develop our evidence base, understand key challenges and common principles applied across the approaches. I know the member will share my resolve to get this right and supports our overarching aspirations to embed equality and human rights in Scotland.
Rhoda Grant.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I thank the Minister for that response. She'll be aware of the recent work the cross-party group on commercial sexual exploitation carried out on commercial websites that sell people for sex, causing misery and turbocharging trafficking. In light of this report, will she look to outlaw online pimping to stop commercial websites profiting from exploitation by advertising prostitution?
Minister.
We are aware of the findings from the cross-party group on commercial sexual exploitation following its inquiry into websites that host adverts for sexual exploitation. We've previously written to the online platforms, including Viva Street, to make our concerns clear and to help ensure people are protected from exploitation. And we'll continue to develop policy in this area as part of our ongoing engagement with the UK Online Harms Bill, and also as part of our work to develop a model for Scotland which challenges men's demand for prostitution.
Thank you. Brief supplementary, Rona Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The recent Equally Safe consultation into challenging men's demand for prostitution highlighted that support for women involved in prostitution should be holistic, person-centred and able to address the multiple underlying needs of many women. Can the Minister outline what the Scottish Government is doing to ensure such support is available to these women?
Briefly, Minister.
The consultation highlighted that we need to do more to ensure that women are able to access appropriate support services which can meet their needs. And we know that services are inconsistent across Scotland, and that's including the services to help people exit prostitution, and our aim is to address this. As part of that, I'm very clear on the need to involve the voices of those involved in prostitution in the design of the services that affect them.
Thank you, Minister. Question number two, Gillian Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how it supports vulnerable people in the prison system.
Cabinet Secretary.
We recognise that increasing numbers of prisoners have a range of multiple and complex needs, and the health needs of the prison population, for example, are particularly challenging. We know that people in custody often have higher rates of substance use issues, mental health problems and complications with physical health in comparison to the general population. The support required to address the often multiple needs of vulnerable people in custody can be multifaceted and is delivered through effective joint working between the prison service and a range of partners, including social care, health, third sector and education authorities.
Gillian Mackay.
There have been a number of serious incidents at Polmont Young Offenders Institution in recent months, including a riot and an inmate being scalded. How is the Scottish Government working with the Scottish Prison Service to ensure the safety of and well-being of young people in Polmont?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think it's fair to say that the safe treatment of any mental health issues of all those in custody, whether Polmont or elsewhere, is a key priority for Scotland's prisons and our prison service. And we take the mental health of all those in custody very seriously. So the SPS is developing a new health and wellbeing strategy for the prison service that recognises the increasing complexities and the underlying health conditions of the prison population in comparison to the wider population. And the Health and Wellbeing Strategy will focus on a public health approach through the organised efforts of the SPS in partnership with those who have responsibilities for delivery of healthcare within prisons. So the new Health and Wellbeing Strategy will provide the overarching framework for all health-related strategies, which include mental health. And I should say we're also undertaking a substantial study in relation to the complexity of needs in this area, and we will produce that report next year, and that will help inform the strategy which I've mentioned.
Thank you. Two brief supplementaries. Firstly, Russell Finn.
Thanks to ITV News, we know that supposedly tamper-proof mobile phones have been hacked and are being used to deal drugs. Organised criminals are targeting vulnerable inmates for the use of their phones. We also know that many of the drugs coming into prison are impregnated in letters. 2 weeks ago...
Question, please, Mr Finlay.
Yep, 2 weeks ago, I asked the Cabinet Secretary to consider photocopying of letters rather than the originals to stem this flow. I'd just like to ask what he has done about that.
Cabinet Secretary.
I think the member will know it's quite a complex area. It's one that was known to the prison service, and they are looking at this now, and officials which were either present at the committee meeting which the member refers to or have listened into are undertaking examination of that proposal. It was a constructive proposal. I take it in that spirit, and I would ask the member to give us the time to look at that seriously and come back to him.
And Pauline McNeill.
Thank you. A Glasgow University study of 200 fatal accident inquiries found that in 90% of cases, sheriffs made no recommendations to improve practices, which I did find surprising. I think the Cabinet Secretary did mention this in the tail end of your answer to Gillian Mackay, but in view of that study, I thought...
Will
the independent review, which I think the Cabinet Secretary referred to, into deaths in custody, which has become a very serious issue for Scotland, will the government commit to implementing the key findings and quickly so we can learn from these past mistakes?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think I'd agree with the thrust of what Pauline McNeill says. I can't say in advance of knowing what the recommendations are, but I think it's a very serious issue. We will look at it seriously, and of course Parliament and the member will have a chance to question on us on that, but we want to take very seriously anything that might improve the situation for prisoners in this area.
Thank you. Question number three, Fulton McGregor, who joins us remotely.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how it will develop the National Community Justice Strategy that was announced in the programme for government.
Cabinet Secretary.
We intend to both review and revise the National Community Justice Strategy and to inform the review of the current strategy, which is a statutory requirement under the Community Justice Scotland Act 2016. We will consult those who work within the community justice sector or closely with it, gathering views from a frontline perspective on how well the strategy has performed over the past 5 years and what might need to be taken into account in updating it. We will then engage with the public through a consultation exercise to explore what approach a revised strategy might take. Our aim will be to consider how a revised strategy can be most effective and how it can build on the progress made over recent years, and also to set clear aims for all involved in delivering services. The views and evidence gathered as part of the consultative and collaborative approach will be used in finalising a new and improved National Community Justice Strategy, which we intend to launch next spring.
Fulton McGregor.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response. The supervision requirement of community payback orders are a very important part of rehabilitation efforts in reducing the number of people in our prisons. Can he confirm if the strategy will consider the expansion of supervision requirements and whether he thinks increased funding will be required for frontline and third sector community justice services involved in their delivery?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think the first thing to say in response to the member is that, as confirmed in the programme for government, the new strategy will include an emphasis on early intervention and encouraging a further shift away from the use of custody where that's appropriate. Community payback orders, which can include supervision as well as a range of other requirements, are a key part of that. Of course, it's up to the sentencing judge to decide the most appropriate sentence in each individual case, including which requirements may be necessary if a CPO is imposed. However, we are committed to investing in a substantive expansion, to answer the member's direct point, of community justice services which underpin the delivery of community sentences, as well as the delivery of a diversion from prosecution and alternatives to remand system. The funding available for community justice services will, as always, be subject to the spending review and parliamentary approval of the draft budget in due course.
Thank you. Brief supplementary, Jamie Green.
Thanks. The last National Strategy for Community Justice back in 2016 promised that our justice system would turn the behaviour of criminals around. So why, therefore, are one in four offenders being reconvicted within a year of their release? Did the last strategy fail?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think the purpose of the review is to look into all those factors. That's fairly obvious from the fact that it was built into the legislation back in 2016 to have that review to look upon past successes and areas for improvement. But I would also say there's been a very substantial improvement in the levels of recidivism, which obviously was an aim of that strategy as well. So, yes, there have been successes, but we should look at this in the round with the review. And, of course, the member will have the chance to comment on that as the review progresses.
Thank you. Question number four, Alistair Allen.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on its plans to introduce parents' houses.
Cabinet Secretary.
We believe that every eligible child victim or witness has a right to consistent and holistic support that enables them to have their voice heard, access specialist services and to recover from their experiences. So we have an unashamedly bold aspiration to create our own parents' houses in Scotland, and our programme for government commitment is obvious in the programme for government. All children in Scotland, it says in that programme, who have been victims or witnesses of abuse or violence, as well as children under the age of criminal responsibility whose behaviour has caused harm, will have access to a parents' house by 2025. And yesterday we published our vision for parents' houses, setting out in broad terms our vision of how Barna House should be implemented in Scotland, the values which should underpin the model and our approach to its practical implementation. The next steps are to establish a national governance group to oversee the delivery of Bairns House in Scotland and bring forward standards for the Bairns House and develop an approach which will build on the momentum of the new Scottish Child Interview model for joint investigative interviews, which is being introduced nationally over the next 3 years, and further plans on this will be published at the end of this year.
Alistair Allen.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. The Bairns House concept has the potential, as he says, to transform the way children in Scotland interact with the criminal justice system. I'd be grateful if he could outline how these plans will ensure better access for those in Ireland and more remote areas. I'm thinking of my own constituency, where the southern part has 130 miles and two bodies of water separating it from the northern part.
Cabinet Secretary.
It's a very good question. I should say I've had discussions with ministers and other portfolios that have responsibility in this area already to see how we address that issue. And of course, the idea is that we shouldn't re-traumatise victims by asking them to move between different locations in order to give the same evidence or have the same interviews. So it's a very important consideration. It does come towards the end of the programme, but there is early thought being given as to how we can make that as accessible as possible. First of all, we agree the overarching principles, and then the flexibility for local delivery partners to adapt the model for their local context, and also recognising the challenges, as the member quite rightly raises, of delivery in rural settings, such as in the members. So the approach that we will take will be based on the quality standards, the European Barna House quality standards, but it should be flexible enough to allow local authorities to tailor Barna House to suit local circumstances, whilst also ensuring, of course, a degree of national consistency for all children eligible for its services.
Thank you. I appreciate slightly shorter answers so we can get as many questions in as possible. Question number five, Oliver Mundell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on its planned consultation on the removal of the not proven verdict.
Cabinet Secretary.
As I made clear in the Chamber last week, our programme for government set out our plans to launch a public consultation on the three verdict system within this parliamentary year.
Oliver Mundell.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer, but the SNP Green programme for government stopped short of committing to abolish the not proven verdict. In 2019-20, not proven was used in 25% of rape cases, even though the verdict was only used in 1% of criminal trials that proceeded to court. Victims have said that the verdict makes them feel no sense of justice and gives them no closure. So why is the Scottish Government making them wait for years to find out whether or not this unjust verdict will end?
Cabinet Secretary.
What we have said is we believe there is a very strong argument that has been presented by some of the people that Oliver Mundell references in favour of it, but there are also other people who have a different point of view, including many members of the legal profession. So why not just go straight to abolishing it? There's two reasons. One, because there doesn't seem to me a great deal of point in a consultation if you're not going to listen to what people have to say. At the very start of the consultation, we want to hear what people have to say in relation to this. And separately, because not proven has a relationship with other parts of the justice system, so we should take that into account. There are interdependencies from the two or three verdict systems with other parts of the jury system and so on. So it's only right that we do that in a sustainable way so we can get to the right solution.
And a brief supplementary, John Mason.
Thank you. Can the Cabinet Secretary assure us that if we are moving towards a two-verdict system, One of the options to be considered will be proven and not proven and nothing else.
Cabinet Secretary.
Again, I would say to the member that there are different views on this, and there are people within the legal profession in particular, but not uniquely, who favour the solution which John Mason has mentioned. And these things were considered to be verdicts that juries understand, as would be the case with guilty and not guilty. But it's also recognition that it may be, in relation to proven and not proven, too, if you like, lawyerly, a distinction that may not be quite as obvious to the general public, and it could perpetuate the stigma and confusion that some believe the current system currently produces. So I think it's right that we consider that as part of the consultation which is going to take place.
Thank you. Question number six, Colin Smith.
Well, thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what steps it's taken to reduce the number of prisoners who are on remand.
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm very clear that action is needed on remand. I've said that before in the Chamber. I know that view is shared in other parties as well. But the effect, first of all, of COVID-19 on the courts has impacted hugely on remand numbers. We've invested £50 million to support the operation of the criminal courts to help increase the throughput of cases and thereby lessen, we hope, the need for remand. However, concern about remand, I think it's only fair to say, predates COVID-19, and that's why the programme for government included the commitment to consultant reform in this area and legislative change being brought forward in year one of this parliament. So we'll continue to invest in and support the provision of alternatives to remand, including additional investment in bail supervision and the implementation of electronically monitored bail.
Colin Smith.
Thank you, President Officer. I thank the Justice Secretary for that answer, but in April the Howard League revealed that over 40% of young people in prison were on remand waiting longer for trials, and the Law Society have even warned that there's now a perverse incentive to plead guilty because you may spend less time in jail. So does the Justice Secretary accept that those shocking levels of remand prisoners, which is adding to the prison overcrowding, shows there is a real need for more urgent action now to get more of our courts back up, open and running, to deal with that huge backlog of cases that have built up during COVID?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I thank the member for his question? I think my previous answer does recognise the urgent needs, and I do recognise it, both in terms of the situation before COVID-19 and how it's been exacerbated ever since. So I think it is true to say areas, for example, like people being held on remand because the court is not certain that they'll be available or come to a subsequent hearing, I think these things have to be looked at. But he's right to say, of course, that we have to increase the pace of cases going through, and we've done that in terms of the remote jury courts and also a substantial expansion in sheriff courts this very month. And the fact that we're taking legislation through in the first year, I think, does show the urgency with which the government's treating this issue.
Thank you. Supplementary, Emma Roddick.
Thank you. One of the 12 new bills announced in the programme for government was the Bail and Release from Custody Bill. Can the Cabinet Secretary outline in what ways the new bill intends to address the use of remand for prisoners?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I thank the member for her question and also say that, following on from my last response, it would be really good if it was possible to do so, to get consensus within the Parliament on this issue. Decision-making, of course, in terms of bail and remand is for the court, but Parliament sets a legislative framework. So prior to COVID-19, there was 20% of the prison population on remand. That is now 27%. And, of course, recent increases will reflect the unique circumstances of the pandemic, but concerns are long-standing. So in the autumn, I intend to publish a consultation on possible changes to bail law. That will seek views on emphasising the importance of public safety as an essential requirement for remand, whilst also proposing legislative changes to ensure an enhanced focus on victim safety, improve the information available to the court when they make their bail decision, and also expand the services available to support the process of reintegration into the community of prisoners leaving remand.
Thank you. And a further brief supplementary, Sharon Dowd.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. One risk when releasing prisoners from remand is that all too often victims are the ones who pay the price. I wrote to the Cabinet Secretary last week about a family who had previously contacted his office. This family have seen their lives devastated by an individual repeatedly released from custody, ruining their lives through a campaign of harassment and intimidation. The Scottish Government has promised
question,
the introduction
please,
of a victims commissioner to prevent similar situations. Can the Cabinet Secretary tell us when we can expect to see the commissioner take up post?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think, once again, it's really important to say that I have every sympathy for your constituent's case, but I would say that the decisions taken on remand are not made by the Scottish Government, they are made by the courts, and the Scottish Government is specifically prohibited from involving themselves in those situations. The way that we can address it is through the legislative framework, which is why we'll bring forward legislation, and all members will get the chance to have a say in that. We've previously said what we intend to do in terms of victims commissioner, and I think it's very important that the victims' organisations currently in existence have their say. Some of them have concerns about the Victims Commissioner. They want to make sure they have their say, first of all, before proceeding.
Thank you. Question number seven, Richard Leonard.
And can I ask the Scottish Government what measures have been put in place to keep prison officers and prisoners safe during the pandemic?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think it's important to say that, to the credit of prison staff, health staff and prisoners, our prisons, for the vast majority of this pandemic, have been settings of low infection rates, and the operation of our prisons has remained safe and stable, not least given the early concerns which were expressed quite rightly. Personal protective equipment was provided to all staff and prisoners at the outset of the pandemic, and robust infection control measures were put in place to limit potential transmission. Recognising SPS staff as key workers also provided access to symptomatic testing early on in the pandemic. The rollout of asymptomatic testing now offers all SPS staff the opportunity to participate in the weekly testing programme. And following the implementation of the SPS pandemic plan, some prison regime changes were put in place to help mitigate the risk of infection, which included minimising the number of individuals who come into contact with others, as well as maintaining physical distancing amongst individuals. As of 6 September, SPS establishments are undertaking asymptomatic testing of all individuals coming into custody from court. COVID vaccination also continues to be offered, and establishments are actively encouraging all prisoners to participate.
Thank you. Richard Leonard.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer? But I am, however, receiving deeply concerning reports that, as a direct consequence of changes to prisoner routine during lockdown, the consumption of illicit drugs, including the psychoactive substance etisolam, has risen exponentially. This has resulted in an increase in violence and erratic behaviour from prisoners, and just 2 days ago at HMP Shotts, two prison officers were stabbed. It's also resulting in an increasing number of prisoners requiring hospital treatment, and they're having to be taken there by prison officers because I am told that GeoAmey is unable to fulfil its contractual obligations. So will the Cabinet Secretary tell us what his plans are to tackle the epidemic of drug use sweeping through our prisons?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I thank the member for his question, which touches on a number of different areas. Of course, we're very alive to some of the issues he's mentioned, especially in relation to psychoactive drugs, because the effect of those drugs on inmates tends to be much more challenging for prison officers than the consumption of other drugs. And we want to eradicate all drugs, obviously, from the prison system. So there's new technology being looked at on top of the existing measures which are there in the first place. However, it is true to say, and I don't shrink away from the fact, that trying to deal with the pandemic and the threat of infections within prisons has limited certain operations within prisons. So we have to try and balance those risks as best that we can. The introduction of new technology, which should help in relation to some of the drugs that he's mentioned, will be one stage in doing that. But I also happen to think there's a more profound change that has to take place in how the prison system deals with instances of prisoners with drug abuse problems, and we're also looking at that.
A couple of supplementaries. Colette Stevenson first.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Cabinet Secretary what steps have been taken to ensure that prisoners can still contact friends and family in a COVID-safe manner. Due to in-person visitation...
Cabinet Secretary.
Sorry.
I thank the member for her question and just say the introduction of virtual visits technology and prison-issued mobile phones in SPS establishments and in cell phones in HMP Kilmarnock has enabled contact to be maintained between those in custody and their friends and families. Since implementation, over 56,900 virtual visits have taken place in the SPS. Precautionary measures have been put in place by the SPS, informed by public health guidance, to make in-person visits as safe as possible.
Thank you. And Tess White.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Cabinet Secretary, it's emerged hundreds of seemingly tamper-proof mobile phones given to prisoners during the pandemic have been hacked and are being used to facilitate drug deals. What immediate action is being taken to discipline the perpetrators and prevent this criminal activity on the prison estate?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, the member will know or should know that the issue of prisoners being disciplined is one for the Scottish Prison Service. They take that decision. If a member wishes, I can ask the Chief Executive, Interim Chief Executive of the Service, to respond to the point that she makes in relation to that. But the benefits of the phones, you've mentioned quite rightly one of the issues with the phones in terms of being tamper-proof, the benefits have been huge in relation to managing prison services which have not been able to operate in the way that they have in the past. I should say one final thing. Discipline within prisons is much harder to maintain if you have 68-year-old prison officers. And that is the effect of the government that she supports in pushing the pension age back to 68. We should never have a situation where we have 68-year-old prison officers trying to exercise the kind of discipline that the member mentions.
And question number 8, Emma Harper.
to ask the Scottish Government when it last discussed the control, use and licensing of shooting ranges and firearms with Police Scotland.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government is in regular contact with Police Scotland regarding a variety of firearms licensing matters, and officials and police work together to manage complementary licensing systems and to ensure that firearms are possessed and used safely across Scotland. Scottish ministers, though, have no role in approving shooting ranges. It's a matter for Police Scotland to be satisfied as to the safety of any land where firearms are used.
Thank you. And as briefly as possible, Emma Harper.
Okay. Esdale Muir is home to the Sami Ling Buddhist Monastery and many agricultural holdings with livestock. And there are concerns with the community over Clark Hill and over Cassock ranges where high-velocity 50-calibre weapons are used in the vicinity. Both ranges are operating sporadically under 28-day planning rule. So given this, could the Minister undertake to properly look into the situation, and could he outline whether, in principle, he would consider removing shooting activities from the 28-day planning rule?
Cabinet Secretary.
I have to say to the member that planning legislation is not within my remit, and it may be that, as well as having raised this with me previously, quite rightly, she maybe wants to talk to ministers who have that responsibility. I do appreciate it's a matter of significant concern, both for the member and the community, but I will assure that my officials will closely engage with Police Scotland regarding shooting ranges in Esdale Muir Valley. I understand the police have already visited these ranges several times in recent months to assess their safety and operation, and plan on doing so in the near future.
Thank you. That's going to have to do it, I'm afraid, Cabinet Secretary. We move on to the next set of questions, portfolio of finance and economy. Again, if members want to ask a supplementary, could they press the request to speak button or put an R in the chat function during the relevant question? Question number one, Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government what action it's taking to support businesses in relation to developing a sustainable green economy.
Minister Richard Lockhead.
Businesses are crucial, of course, to achieving net zero, and funding and technical support for businesses to develop a sustainable green economy is being provided through our enterprise and skills agencies. In advance of COP26, we have also targeted commitments to drive opportunities for Scottish businesses. For example, we have set out an additional £2 billion of infrastructure investment over this Parliament to stimulate demand and create jobs in the net zero transition. And this includes our £100 million Green Jobs Fund, offering support to businesses to invest in green products and services and in research and development.
Brian Whittle.
I thank the Minister for that answer. He will be aware of a recent report that says that half of Scottish businesses are yet to develop a net zero policy. And I wonder if the Cabinet Secretary, I wonder if the Minister agrees with me that the focus on new green jobs in the green economy forgets the importance of helping current industry to become greener. And this is just as important as the drive in the drive towards a green economy.
Minister.
Thank you, and Brian Whittle makes a number of valid points there. It's really important we all work together across the Chamber to raise awareness of net zero among Scotland's business community, and they will be at the heart of this country's success in creating thousands of new green jobs and also achieving our targets. And of course, there is the Race to Zero, the commitment that we ask Scottish businesses to sign up to achieve net zero. And this is Climate Week, so we're using this week also to promote that message, and all members may wish to do so locally as well in their constituencies.
Thank you. Supplementary, Bill Kidd.
Thank you very much. Can the Cabinet Secretary provide an update as to the Scottish Government's work to support workers in carbon-intensive sectors to upskill, reskill and transition to the green jobs of the future, please?
Minister.
As Mr Kidd mentions, ensuring that people have good green jobs going forward is absolutely crucial to achieving our net zero targets and delivering a just transition. And there's a number of measures in place, and of course we have our Climate Emergency Skills Action Plan, and flowing from that we have the National Transition Training Fund, which is funding a lot of programmes across the country to ensure employees are able to retrain, upskill for greener industries if that's required. And of course we just recently launched our Green Jobs Skills Academy as well, and the Programme for Government also had within it a commitment for a skills guarantee for anyone who is in a carbon intensive industry who wishes to retrain for a lower carbon sector job as well. So there's a number of initiatives underway, but this is absolutely the heart of a just transition for the people of Scotland.
Thank you. Sue Webber.
I think I've got a supplementary after Mr Johnson.
That is fine. We'll move on to question number two, Michelle Thompson.
to ask the Scottish Government what progress has been made on agreeing the scope of the fiscal framework review scheduled for 2022 with the UK Government.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, we are actively engaging with the UK Government, have been since December, on options for the scope of the review, as well as the independent report which precedes it. I personally believe that the review and the preceding report should be broad in scope to give full consideration to how the framework has performed and to assess how Brexit and the pandemic have impacted funding arrangements. I've been pushing for a meeting with the Chief Secretary to the Treasury to take place as quickly as possible to progress that.
Thank you. Michelle Thompson.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response. Recent research by the Fraser of Allender Institute and others has noted that the UK Government, as she confirms, is seeking a very narrow scope to the review. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree? What is needed is it to be broadened out, for example, to consider the sufficiency of capital borrowing powers and the policy risks that arise when UK Government decisions constrain the Scottish Government?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I would strongly agree on the need for a broad scope, but I think that position is actually shared by quite a number of external stakeholders as well. Obviously, we've had a Parliament's worth of experience. We need to give proper consideration to how the framework is performing. And I think it's critical that the Scottish Parliament and the Government have in place appropriate powers and flexibilities in order to manage the risks that we face through the operation of the framework, responding to fast evolving pressures and challenges, and obviously tackling economic recovery.
Supplementary, Liz Smith.
Could I ask the Cabinet Secretary what measures the Scottish Government is going to put in place to assist with improving the transparency in Scottish Government fiscal policy, given the concerns that we heard at committee yesterday about the need for a much better understanding of the fiscal framework and Audit Scotland's concerns about enhanced financial transparency?
I think it's a really important question from the member, because obviously the fiscal framework is still relatively new, the devolution of tax power is still relatively new, and it's important that we are as transparent as possible and help the public and indeed other stakeholders to understand how these things operate. Obviously last year we made a number of steps to aid that transparency, including an additional budget revision during the year and the publication of the medium-term financial strategy. But I am open to suggestions, including from the Finance Committee, as to how that can be bolstered.
Thank you. Question number three, Stuart McMillan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what discussions it's had with Ferguson Marine Port Glasgow Limited regarding the building of vessels for CMAL.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I visited the yard and spoke directly to workers on the 25th of August. I also meet regularly with the Chair and the Turnaround Director to monitor progress, most recently meeting on the 17th of August, and I'll meet again with the full board at the yard on the 23rd of September.
Thank you. Stuart McMillan.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for that reply. And as the Cabinet Secretary will know, I'm not just a local MSP, but I grew up in the town and my father worked for the yard before he passed away. I'm a huge supporter of the workforce and the yard, and its future is bigger than one person. After yesterday's news about the two Isla vessels, which is uncomfortable but not unexpected, will the Cabinet Secretary now instigate a change of management at the yard to ensure that the men and women of Ferguson Marine Port Glasgow Limited have a future, and will she agree to meet with me to discuss the future of the yard?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, can I certainly agree to meeting with the member and agree with the sentiment about how important it is to ensure a long-term future for the yard? Can I emphasise to the member that all of our actions and decisions must be to ensure those vessels are completed and the yard has a long-term future, and I weigh up all decisions within my own powers on that basis. Leadership does matter, and I'm monitoring progress at the yard closely through the board, who ultimately oversee operational matters and hold management accountable for performance. I'll be meeting the board next week, as I said, and I've been crystal clear with the yard's management that I expect, no ifs, no buts, the two vessels to be completed and the yard to get into a position to compete successfully for tenders.
Thank you. And a couple of supplementaries. First, Graeme Simpson.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I ask the Finance Secretary, when is the turnaround director going to turn anything around at the yard? And when is somebody's head going to roll over this shambles?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, on the basis of recent progress, we need to ensure the two priorities that I've just outlined are met. The first is that those two vessels are completed. We have seen progress at the yard, but we still need to get those two vessels over the line. And as I mentioned in my previous answer, having most recently visited the yard at the end of August, spoken directly to workers, I am confident that progress is being made. The second point in terms of the future opportunities, the yard have two substantial vessels to complete. This is not the last CMAL vessel. In fact, it is the first procurement of £580 million of investment over the next 5 years to bring new vessels into service, including up to 7 new ships under phase one of the small vessel replacement programme. We have no role in line with normal procurement rules, but we want to ensure that the yard is in a position to compete successfully on an international basis when it comes to those tenders.
Thank you. And Neil Bibby.
The government's announcement yesterday was a hammer blow for Scottish shipbuilding. It's about time ministers took responsibility for the SNP's ongoing ferries fiasco. Turning around Ferguson's means no more delays to current contracts and filling the order book again. To confirm, will the Cabinet Secretary rule out any further delays to Glensannox and Hull 8 too, yes or no? Were existing delays a factor in Ferguson's not making the shortlist, and will she publish the assessment criteria? And given public concern, will she suspend this process and consider again a direct award to the yard?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, Presiding Officer, there was a lot of questions in there and I may not got through all of them. I think just on one of the points you mentioned, I think we should, on behalf of island communities, recognise that yesterday's announcement regarding 2 new vessels for ferry routes is an important and welcome addition. We know, certainly I do, representing ferry island communities that rely on lifeline ferries, just how important it is to ensure that there are new ferries into those lifeline services. In terms of the other questions he asked, I monitor progress closely through the board. I meet regularly to monitor that progress, and I have been absolutely crystal clear that we expect those 2 vessels to be delivered and for the yard to be in a position to compete. And the turnaround director will update the committee at the end of September as previously set out.
Question number 4, Bill Kidd.
Thank you very much. To ask the Scottish Government what discussions it has had with stakeholders regarding continuing ATM use and accessibility.
Minister Ivan McKee, who joins us remotely.
Whilst we are encouraged to use contactless payments due to the pandemic, we recognise this is not always possible for everyone. Limited ATM accessibility is a matter of great concern affecting many communities across Scotland. British Government ministers engage regularly with the banking sector through bilateral ministerial meetings and the Financial Service Industry Advisory Board, FISAB. British Government stands ready to work constructively with the UK Government, banks and other stakeholders to ensure that customers, local communities and businesses have access to the banking facilities they need.
Bill Kidd.
Thank the Minister for that. And, can I ask the Minister that I haven't spoken to ATM provider Note Machine, and they highlighted that higher rates paid by ATMs in Scotland have not been considered in the setting of interchange fees applied across the UK. This means particular pressure in ATMs in Scotland means more money has to be withdrawn per machine to meet costs, and that can cause real problems in poorer areas. Can the Minister please advise on what interventions are open to the Scottish Government to assist in keeping the cost of these machines affordable so they remain equally available to communities across Scotland?
Minister.
The Scottish Government already delivers a number of reliefs for ATM sites, such as continuing to ensure that sites of ATMs in rural areas are exempt from rating, including buildings which are only used for that ATM, more widely up to 100% rate relief through the Small Business Bonus Scheme, and each local council has wide-ranging powers to create rate relief to reflect local needs under the Community Empowerment Scotland Act. Shops which have an ATM inside may also be eligible for 100% rates, retail, hospitality, leisure and aviation relief in both 2021 and 21-22. Further, I am meeting the CEO of the Financial Conduct Authority on Thursday 16 September, where I will be directly raising access to cash infrastructure.
Thank you. And brief supplementaries. First, Douglas Lumpton.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. An alternative to ATMs for many has been to withdraw cash from the local post office, but we've also seen a large number of post office closures. How will the government ensure our vulnerable and elderly can access their cash without being shortchanged by extortionate fees?
Thank you. Minister.
The member will be aware that financial services are obviously reserved, and we continue to work with the UK Government and others to ensure that services are maintained. As I indicated, a meeting with the FCA shortly, and that will be a subject for discussion in terms of access to cash infrastructure across Scotland.
Thank you. And question number 5, Daniel Johnson.
to the Scottish Government how the Finance Secretary plans to allocate the Barnett consequentials arising from the UK Government's recent announcement of additional funding for NHS England.
Cabinet Secretary.
To passing all of health and care resource consequentials on to health and social care. We've sought urgent clarity from the UK Government as to the level of net additional consequentials that will arise from their recent announcement. Despite that request, they've not given a firm commitment as yet, they've not given a firm guarantee as yet to the value of the consequentials and that it will be a net addition to the budget. And I'm sure the member will join me in urging the UK Government to give that clarity and to ensure that it is actually additional.
Daniel Johnson.
Well, clarity is obviously important, but the need for this question is perhaps best set out in the Audit Scotland report published today, as indicated by Liz Smith. But could I ask the Cabinet Secretary to be specific? Will she commit to publishing a schedule of regular budget and spend updates that transparency demands, rather than have this chamber rely on ad hoc budget revisions?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank the member for that question, and I think he makes a valid point around ensuring that Parliament is kept updated with progress on spend. It's why last year I tried to do additional budget revisions. I think one of the challenges that we face that the Audit Scotland report alluded to is the fact that when announcements are made south of the border, often those figures are not actually confirmed until the main estimates. Now, that could be very late on in the financial year, which makes it difficult for us to use those figures as estimates to make decisions, but without having the clarity that that figure is fixed. Last year, we obviously had the guarantee, which helped, and I would call on the UK Government to reinstate that guarantee to help us provide that transparency to Parliament.
Thank you. And brief supplementary, Sue Webber.
Yes, this time. Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Last week, the SNP MPs in Westminster voted against the £1.1 billion of extra NHS funding. And even though our health service is in crisis and the SNP Government has called for more money from the UK Government, the SNP MPs refused to back an extra £1.1 billion of annual funding for Scotland's NHS and social services. Can the Cabinet Secretary explain why the SNP MPs voted against giving more money to the NHS and social care in Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I think the member somewhat mischaracterises it last week. But the point I would make to her is that if she can confirm that that money is indeed additional to our budget and that every penny will come to the Scottish Government, we will ensure that that goes directly on frontline spend. The issue, of course, that's been well documented with the rise in national insurance is that it will have a devastating impact across some of the most vulnerable families, working families. It's the first time I've heard a Tory calling tax rises a union dividend.
Question number six, Martin Whitfield.
I'm grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government what discussions the Finance Secretary has had with the Education Secretary regarding the allocation of additional funding to improve ventilation in schools and help reduce the spread of COVID-19.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, we are in agreement, the Education Secretary and I are in agreement that ventilation is one of the most important ways in which we can reduce the risk of airborne COVID-19 transmission and keep our schools as safe as possible. We're providing local authorities with an additional £10 million to ensure that schools and childcare settings have access to CO2 monitoring, and a previous allocation of £90 million of COVID-19 logistics funding was also provided to local authorities to use for improved ventilation.
Martin Whitfield.
I'm grateful for that answer and I welcome the comments, but obviously CO2 monitoring is not in relation to ventilation, but in relation to a build-up of a gas that may indicate a risk of COVID. How is the Scottish Government measuring the effectiveness of the spend, and will adequate funding be provided to local councils going forward so that the education estate can be maintained properly?
I thank the member for that question, which is a very legitimate and important question. A reporting mechanism has been established to track the progress of each authority. That's after agreement with local authorities, and it covers four key areas and requests details on the purchase and supply of monitors, additional staff and our training requirements, building assessments, and most importantly, the impacts detailing any remedial action. And local authorities are keeping us updated of any significant developments, particularly on the identification of high-risk, poorly ventilated areas, and importantly, what remedial action they are taking.
Question number seven, Alexander Burnett, who joins us remotely.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what discussions the Finance Secretary has had with the Health Secretary regarding the allocation of additional funding for the Scottish Ambulance Service to increase staffing and resources, particularly in rural and remote areas.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, as somebody who represents a rural and remote area, I know the importance of the question. Scotland's ambulance service has been under significant pressure due to the pandemic, with ambulance staff at the forefront of our response. The service is currently carrying out our national review of demand and capacity, and that will ensure that the right resources are in place across the country, including in rural and remote areas, to help meet present, but also importantly, future demand. We've made available £10.5 million last year and £20 million this year to support that review, and that has already resulted in the North gaining a total of 67 extra frontline staff, a mixture of experienced paramedics, newly qualified paramedics, technicians and patient transport staff.
Thank you. Alexander Burnett.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. I know that the same problems face her own constituency as myself. My constituency of Aberdeenshire West, Braemar, has had significant issues with ambulance services, which have had tragic consequences. I've been in contact with the Scottish Ambulance Service and Braemar Community Council, but a major issue is funding, and they're looking at the cost of purchasing a 4x4 Caravelle ambulance to replace the existing co-responder van. But can I ask, has it come to this, that communities are now so abandoned by the Scottish Government, they must now fundraise for their own emergency services? Or does the Cabinet Secretary endorse Hamza Yousaf's view that people in rural areas should think twice before calling 999?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I will always represent people in rural areas, and I obviously, as I've just said, represent some of the most remote and rural areas in the country. Now, the points that Alexander Burnett have raised won't all be solved through funding. I've already outlined the funding position. Obviously, coming up to next year's budget, I will be in discussions with the Cabinet Secretary on health and spend, and certainly we've seen the ambulance services budget rise in real terms by 17.7% between 2011 and 2021. However, in light of the very serious issues he raises, I'm sure that if he were to raise that with the Health Secretary, then the Health Secretary would look into the specifics, and I'd be happy to pass on a note as a result of this exchange.
Thank you. And a brief supplementary, Carol Mochan.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can the Minister assure us that the allocation of funds takes into account that the problem with ambulances, certainly in my own area of South of Scotland, being unavailable, has been exacerbated by ambulance crews waiting at hospitals for record periods of time to hand over patients, and that fixing this problem requires greater staffing and resources at all points of the emergency service chain?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think the member raises an important point about the integration of health and social care, of the full service, and making sure that investment in one part of the health service does often relieve pressure elsewhere. And I know that that's a key theme when it comes to the remobilisation plan, and quite clearly when it comes to next year's budget, we will be looking very carefully right across the NHS, the health and social care, to ensure that we're spending money in the right places to relieve pressures elsewhere.
Thank you. And finally, question number 8, Faisal Chowdhury.
Thank you. Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what discussion the Finance Secretary has had with the Culture Secretary regarding the allocation of funding for the culture, arts and events sector in light of the impact of COVID-19.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, we recognise the value of culture and its importance in our recovery, and that's why substantial funding was made available during COVID for businesses that work in the culture, arts and events sector. I have regular dialogues with the Culture Secretary as part of Cabinet discussions, and those will be ongoing as we prepare for next year's budget.
Faisal Chowdhury.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response. A recent Skill Development Scotland Skills Assessment report on the creative industries forecast a GVA increase of 28% in the sector by 2031 from the current level. This will be good news for my constituents in Edinburgh and Lothian and for the economy more generally. But can the Cabinet Secretary outline how the Scottish Government will open up and increase career paths in the creative industries for those who are currently marginalised and excluded from these opportunities? For example, those from working class backgrounds, from black and minority ethnic communities and from other underrepresented communities?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I thank the member for that question, and it's a hugely important one, and he reflects on the contribution that the culture sector makes to our economic performance, and that's one that we recognise and I hope will be reflected in our 10-year economic strategy, which will be published in the autumn. In terms of career paths, I think it's something that SDS do need to take seriously. We need to ensure that there are equal opportunities, and again, because it's not directly within my portfolio, I'd be very happy to raise that with my colleague to ensure that he's raising those issues specifically with the member.
Thank you very much indeed, and that now concludes portfolio questions. We